evening, everyone.
Good evening.
You're all very welcome to this, the third of our Holy Week services. I just have to mention that Tony's booklet sold out. It sell out on Monday night. It sell out Tuesday night. But never made it to Tuesday night. So there are more books at the front door on your way out if you were had your eye on one and you were thinking of getting it but didn't manage. But listen, you're very welcome here to St. Gall's tonight. It's great to have the three churches gather as we approach the wonder that is Easter. Well, we have our order of service and that will guide you through everything. There are a few different hymns there. So the red hymn books are in the pew in front of you. And we have the help that we're getting from Sandra and from Rick who are reading and leading our prayers. Thank you to them for doing that. Well, listen, we're going to stand now and look to the words of greeting that are there at the beginning of the order of service. The light and peace of Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
As our evening prayer rises before you, O God, so may your mercy come down on us to cleanse our hearts and set us free to sing your praise now and forever. Amen. We sing our opening hymn, hymn 231. My song is Love and Hope.
Show me your love.
and pure, all that is lovable and attractive, whatever is excellent and admirable. Fill our thoughts with these things, and the God of peace will be with us. So we sit or kneel to pray. Let us pray. Lord God, whose blessed Son, our Saviour, gave his back to the smiters and did not hide his face from shame, give us grace to endure the sufferings of this present time with sure confidence in the glory that shall be revealed through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord.
Amen.
And we say together, Almighty and everlasting God, you hate nothing that you have made, and forgive the sins of all those who are penitent. Create and make in us new and contrite hearts, that lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, we may receive from you, the God of all mercy, perfect forgiveness and peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Our reading tonight is taken from Mark chapter 14, beginning at verse 43. Jesus arrested. Just as he was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, appeared. With him was a crowd armed with swords and cloaks, sent from the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them. The one I kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard. Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, Rabbi, and kissed him. The men seized Jesus and arrested him. Then one of those standing near drew his sword and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Am I leading a rebellion, said Jesus, that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I was with you, teaching in the temple courts, and you did not arrest me. But the scriptures must be fulfilled. Then everyone deserted him and fled. A young man, wearing nothing but a linen garment, was following Jesus. When they seized him, he fled naked, leaving his garment behind. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, we're going to have our anthem now. It's titled Locus Iste, and the translation of that is This Place is Made by God.
Oh,
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
It's a privilege to preach in a Church of Ireland church in Bangor. And I'm aware, particularly after the last anthem, that I'm in a sacred place. The first Presbyterian ministers in Ireland were afforded what would now be called ecumenical hospitality. They were actually preachers in Anglican pulpits. And the first amongst them was Robert Blair of Bangor. So it's a privilege, in a sense, to follow in his footsteps this evening. In Holy Week, we've been looking at how things that should belong together during Holy Week are torn apart. So on Monday, we looked at torn purpose. Last night, the torn soul. And tonight, we're looking at a torn cloth. Now, the Gospels are not like Facebook and Instagram. On social media, we all tend to put up nice photographs of ourselves. We post photos of ourselves spruced up for a wedding, or with small babies and children, or selfies on holiday at iconic tourist sites. We earn likes and shares in abundance as we smile and pose. But the Gospels do not post pictures of Jesus and his disciples posing beside nice views of the Sea of Galilee. Rather, the Gospels intentionally show the shadow side, the dark side, and even the dark humour. Mark chooses to share a story that does not appear in any other gospel, and it's an embarrassing, bizarre incident with a touch of humour. It's also a very significant incident. Jesus and his disciples had already been celebrating the Passover, what became known as the Last Supper. And then they moved into the Garden of Gethsemane, where they had an all-night prayer meeting. Last night we looked at how Jesus' soul was torn with anguish. And then Judas made his appearance as a traitor. A mob arrests Jesus. But the disciples make a quick escape. In the confusion, one young man is apprehended. He is grabbed to be arrested. But he does make his escape by wriggling out of his clothes and streaking naked into the night. Now, I immediately ask the question, why is such a funny, bizarre, but embarrassing story inserted into Mark's Gospel? Remember, Mark's Gospel is the shortest of the four, and he only normally chooses to record what he thinks is significant. So notice firstly the terror of flight. The scene in the garden is certainly one of terror. Mark informs us of mobs, weapons, swords, and clubs. While they're described as a crowd or mob, they had heavyweight backers. Hovering in the background are the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the elders. A trinity of awesome authority. We know that the chief priest's personal servant was among the crowd. The ferocity and surprise of the attack, the sudden disturbance, and the quietness of the garden all lead to terror. Now, do you know what happens to us when we feel under threat? Our bodies respond. So, our skin goes pale, our heart rate increases, our pupils dilate, and our bodies tremble. In the 1920s, American physiologist Walter Cannon was the first to describe the fight or flight response. Cannon realized that a chain of rapidly occurring reactions inside the body helped to mobilize the body's resources to deal with threatening circumstances.
So we tend to respond to terror by flight or fight. We seem to be genetically programmed to either stand up to the aggressor and fight back, or to flee, putting maximum distance between us and the aggressor. So let me give you two examples, one's trivial, the other very serious. I'm sure if you go out for a walk, there are plenty of nice places to walk around Bangor, and you might meet a big dog off a lead. And you'll either go into fight mode or flight mode. You face the dog, you eyeball him, and you say, I'm going to search you out. Or if you're like me, you just run. Get it? Fight or flight. So that's a trivial one, but the serious one is if you think of Ukraine. So great was the terror of Russia that Ukrainians are doing one of two things. Some are opting to fight, arming themselves to defend their homeland, ordinary citizens taking up arms. The second option for Ukrainians is to flee. And you saw that? To board trains, cars, buses, and airplanes. To head west to neighboring countries. And move as far away as possible from their Russian aggressors. Some are now my neighbors in Dungannon. In the situation of terror, Jesus is actually abandoned by his friends. Already during the prayer meeting, when Jesus asked James, John, and Peter, his closest friends, to watch and pray, they failed to discern the significance of what he was asking and fell asleep. It was not a good look. You wouldn't have put that on Facebook. Judas calculated that Jesus was against him, and then chose to become a betrayer. Mark tells us how he identified Jesus to the mob by planting a kiss on his cheek, a betrayer's kiss. Peter chose to meet terror by going into fight mode. He takes out his sword and cuts off the ear of the chief priest's servant. He meets terror with fight. And then this young man, who most commentators suspect was Mark himself, chose to flee the scene. See, he was young enough to still possess the vigour to sprint. He wanted to remove himself from the scene because he feared what may occur to him. He flees from the chaos and the evil, but he also flees from Jesus, the terror of the flight. And then secondly, the shame of the flight. Readers down the centuries can imagine the scene on a hot night. A young man wearing only linen shorts is grabbed by a husky bodyguard. He wriggles himself free and is seen streaking into the night. The terror of arrest is worse than the shame of flight. He's ashamed to be seen with Jesus in this pressure cooker situation. His bravery, his courage, his faith, his clothes, and his dignity desert him as he scarpers. But it's interesting that later Mark is to become a faithful follower of Jesus. He accompanies Paul, Barnabas, on a missionary trip, and he records the story of Jesus in what we call Mark's Gospel. So it's obvious that the fleeing Mark later experiences the grace of God and the forgiveness of God. His flight is not the end of the story. He is later used by the Holy Spirit in a leadership capacity. The one to flee becomes the one to use his gifts to serve. Now, I was wondering playfully how this incident would be treated in the 21st century world. Well, someone in the crowd would take out their phone and record the incident, wouldn't they? Next morning, it would be posted on social media, causing much merriment and disgust. There would be lots of comments. Years later, when Mark is being considered a potential missionary, an internet search would be done. And he'd be identified with face recognition as the one who ran away. And so he's cancelled, and we would not have Mark's gospel. I sometimes wonder, have we become an unforgiving, graceless age that no longer allows for maturity, forgiveness, grace, growth, and even humour? I don't know about you, but I do understand how this young man, Mark, felt. I confess, when I was young, I tended to flee. The terror situation for me would have been a classroom of boys at the Royal School of Dungannon. Religion was not popular in school, even back then. And those who claimed to be Christians were dismissed as either hypocrites or Bible bashers. I didn't really want to be either of those two. While I had made a profession of faith as a child, attended Sunday school, church, and even crusader class on a Sunday afternoon, I did feel ashamed as a Christian. I stayed silent when Christianity was mentioned in class. I avoided being identified with Scripture Union or other informal gatherings of Christians. I kept my head down and walked away from any embarrassing situations. I felt shame. But I do remember when I faced down my shame. I was about 15 years old, and I'd been to a coffee bar in the Moy Presbyterian Church and felt challenged to confess my faith. I attended a prayer meeting organized by Scripture Union and then explained to my friends what I was doing. And you know, soon I found some of my friends were also emboldened to confess their faith. And by sixth form, it was a time of great blessing. God forgives our shame and helps us to confess our faith. We may flee, but we don't have to flee forever. Recently, I read a book, All the Broken Places, by John Boyne. It's an adult follow-up to the children's book and movie, The Boy with the Striped Pajamas. Probably know it. That book, later a movie, was set in Auschwitz. And the son of the commander of Auschwitz meets a Jewish boy of his own age who wears what he thinks are striped pajamas. In the follow-up, Boyne develops the character of Gretel, the sister. And the book is really exploring the concept of guilt. Now, we were on holiday in Australia when I was reading it, and Gretel chose flight to deal with her guilt. So, where would you go to? As far away from Europe as possible. So she headed to Australia, to Sydney. And as he mentions in the book, Kent Street in Sydney, I was reading the book on the next street. And her friend worked in the pub, and we drove past the pub as well. At one stage, Gretel finds herself in a psychiatric hospital. And this is what she says about guilt. Guilt was what kept you awake in the middle of the night. Or if you managed to sleep, poisoned your dreams. Guilt intruded upon any happy moment, whispering in your ear that you had no right to pleasure. Guilt followed you down streets, interrupting the most mundane moments with remembrances of days and hours when you could have done something to prevent tragedy, but chose to do nothing. When you chose to play with your dolls instead. Guilt about the past can paralyze us in the present. But there were times reading that novel when I wanted to say to the fictional Gretel, pause, don't run away anymore. Enjoy the forgiveness of God, who gives us another opportunity to serve him again. In contrast, I want to talk a bit about a real person, not somebody in a novel. In 2019, I attended a conference on reconciliation in St Andrews University in Scotland. And one of the speakers was a man who's now in his 90s, Jürgen Moltmann. He's possibly the leading theologian of the 20th century. Like Greta, Wolfman had lived a life consumed by guilt. About the same thing. He was conscripted to serve in the German army during the Second World War. But then he heard stories of how the Nazis were treating the Jews. He felt overwhelming shame as a German and overwhelming guilt. He was quickly captured. He was brought to Scotland, Kilmarnock, and he was put in a prisoner of war camp. He felt so guilty for his part in this genocidal injustice that he was suicidal. He saw no purpose in life. And then an American chaplain gave him a Gideon Bible. God was not finished with Wolfman. He read the Bible, he gave his life to Christ, and dedicated his life to understanding the suffering God. He came to the conference because he wanted to go back to Scotland where it all started. And he knew he wasn't going to do it for too long. But he's still going 4 years later. The terror of the flight, the shame of the flight, and then thirdly, the significance of the flight. As I suggested earlier, Mark is very fussy about what he includes in the gospel. So the nakedness of a fleeing young man has a deeper significance in the scriptures. The incident in the Garden of Gethsemane brings us back to the first garden, the Garden of Eden. Remember, Adam and Eve were naked initially, but not ashamed. But after the fall, sin enters the world, and one of the results is that they become ashamed, self-conscious, and they cover themselves with leaves. Now, Jews, unlike their Greek counterparts, abhorred nakedness. If naked, they are ashamed. The gospel, the good news, is that God clothes us in the righteousness and courage of Jesus. Psalm 45 describes us as his royal daughters, clothed in beautiful robes, standing before the king. Beginning of Zechariah, there is a powerful scene that unfolds when Joshua, the high priest, is accused by Satan. I'm going to read that bit. Then he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. And the Lord said to Satan, "The Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord has chosen Jerusalem. Rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire?" John Wesley line, by the way. Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and was standing before the angel. Then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, "Take away the filthy garments from him." And to him he said, "See, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes." And then in the final book in the Bible, Revelation, we are given a picture of being before the throne of God. And instead of feeling ashamed of our nakedness, we are clothed in the very best clothes, fine linen. Revelation 19. "Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has been made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright. For the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints." This is the gospel for you this evening. No matter how you have sinned, you may have stood and fought. You may have indulged in flight and not confessed your faith. But this evening, put on Christ's righteousness. Let his love, his courage, his faith cover you. be clothed in the righteousness of Jesus. Amen.
Stand and sing the hymn, hymn 224, How Deep the Father's Love for Us.
Father, you know all of us as we sit here tonight. You know everything about us. You know the very hairs on our head. You know what our thoughts are when we get up, when we go to bed tonight. Lord, you know everything about us. And I thank you that we can come here tonight and we can think about your word, your truth, your light in our lives. And Father, we just want to say, as we just want to talk to you now, that you are our faithful Father. You are a God who loves us and has compassion on us. And no matter what situations we're going through, no matter what the disciples were going through in the garden, the fear that led to flight, the chaos that was there whenever the high priest's servant got his ear cut off, no matter what the situations we face in our lives, all the concerns that gnaw away at us, all the fears and worries, all the pride that we sometimes face as well. Father, I thank you that in the bleakest of days, in the most wonderful of days, that you never change, and we can declare, as your word says, that you are good. You are good, and that your love endures forever. Father, I thank you that you hear us when we speak to you. Lord, all of us, every single one of us, have fallen short of the standard you've set. And yet in our own lives, we like to look at other people and we go, well, I'm maybe not as bad as them. But Father, for all of us, everybody in here, we haven't loved you the way we should have loved you. We don't love you with all our heart, our soul, our strength, and our mind. And we don't love our neighbor as ourselves. And yet, in the middle of all of that, we have this fear of confession. We fear that you're going to spotlight things in our lives. Father, I pray that you would just open our eyes and our hearts. That you would draw us near as that loving Heavenly Father. And that we would see that you want to tend to those things in our lives that we need to get resolved. So, Father, for all of us, I pray that we would just learn that you want us to come to you and tell you the things that we've done wrong, because you know them. Lord, forgive us our sins, I pray. Father, we pray for the congregation that is in this place. We pray for the three congregations that are represented, that they will be bold and full of light. Because, Father, we have been forgiven, that we would long to share that forgiveness with other people. Father, we pray for those in our families, for those in the streets that we meet that don't know you. Father, just break our hearts for them, that they too might come to know you and know that you are God eternal and that you love them so much. Father, I pray that we would all be one. Despite that we're coming from three different churches, we'd all be one, brothers and sisters in you. And I pray for all of us, that out of your glorious riches, that you may strengthen us with power through your Spirit in our inner beings, so that Christ may dwell in our hearts through faith. And as Paul prays, Father, I pray that we would be rooted and established in love, and that we would have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and that we would know this love that surpasses knowledge, and that we would be filled to the measure of all the fullness of you, Father. We ask all these things because we can, because you love us so much. Hear our cries to you, Nami, in our hearts, and as I speak them out. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.
As we continue to pray, I'd like to turn our minds to the blessing of God. We focus our thoughts on what God wants to give each one of us. May God bless you with this comfort of easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice and freedom and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and war, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and to turn their pain to joy. May God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in this world, so that you can do what others claim cannot be done. The blessing of God, who creates, redeems, and sanctifies, be upon you and all those whom you love and pray for this day and forevermore. Amen. Amen. We stand and sing the hymn 244, There Is a Green Hill Far Away.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.